Hello, Math 7 students. This is Utah Middle School Math Project 4.3A, Writing Proportions. Before we begin this lesson, I want to review. Take a second to write down everything you know about proportional relationships. How you organize this is up to you. You can create a circle map, you can write a paragraph, or you can even just make a list. So pause the video long enough for you to make that happen, and we'll return and listen to student answers. Okay, we're back. Let's hear from you guys. What are some things that you know about proportional relationships? Because I'm going to be hearing from a bunch of people, I'm going to just make like a list of things. Even if you formatted it differently, I think that as a class, this is probably one of the better ways to do that. Get me started, please, Gabe. No addition. I think you mean in the equation, right? Okay, no addition in the equation. Because he started us off with equations, what else do we know about equations? We know there's going to be no addition in the equation. Seth? Okay, let me, no addition or subtraction. Solve that in one go. No addition, subtraction in the equation. What else do we know about the equations, though? We know what they don't have. What do they have? Danielle?
Multiplication or division.
Yep, they do have multiplication or division. And even though we can have division, what is the best way to write them? I prefer that multiplication, right? So specifically, what is the format of the equation? Equations have the format. They all look like one certain type of equation. Seth? Perfect. X times whatever number, which we've used the variable k is equal to y, or y equals kx. Got anything else about equations? Those are the most important things. Yes. They do have variables. Yeah, and I think that we covered that here with this y equals kx, just showing that format of that. So equations in the form x times k equals y, or y equals kx, where k is what? What does that k need to represent, Seth? It would be the unit rate, but because of the way that we're looking at it, we normally would call it the constant of proportionality. Good. So let's talk about constants of proportionality and unit rate. Let's start our list there. What do you know about the constants of proportionality? Seth? Good. So the constant of proportionality is the number we multiply by as we go across the table. Carter. Good. So it would need to be consistent. Therefore, that's why we call it the constant of proportionality, right? The constant of proportionality is constant. It's the same throughout. I'm going to write this down because it was mentioned. Seth tried saying that the k represents the unit rate, which it is, but let's also acknowledge that the unit rate is the same as the constant of proportionality. Good. What else? Seth, again, Seth knows a lot about proportionality. Perfect. Graphs are straight lines through the origin. What else do we know about proportional relationships? Danielle.
On the left side, then there should be a zero on the right side.
Good. So graphs are straight lines through the origin. That means that they would have the coordinate 0, 0. So we'd see that on the table as well. On a table, if the x value is 0, then that y value on the right-hand side would also need to be 0 because remember, this represents the origin, which the graph would have to go through. Great connections. I can't tell whose hand that is. Is that Dex? Dexton. The constant of proportionality is a multiplication relationship. Great. Anything else? Who learned something from someone else today and wrote something down that wasn't already on your paper because someone else shared it? Okay, great. Who's happy that we took the time to review this? Because winter break was unkind to our learning. It was unkind to my work ethic, I'll tell you that. It was unkind to my, yeah. I enjoyed sleeping in a little bit too much, I think. Let's take a look at our lesson 4.3a class activity on writing proportions. So what we're going to be looking at today, we're going to be, to start off, we're going to look at the same problem, all the different methods that we've used to look at it and solve it in the past. And then I'm going to introduce a fourth method, which is somewhat familiar, but we're going to look at it a little bit differently, than we have in the past. And it's going to end up being a lot quicker to solve these proportions. But before we can get to the solving of them, we have to know how to write them. And that's what today's lesson is all about. So, this problem, Jennifer received $9 for 2 hours of babysitting. At this rate, if she babysat for 27 hours last month, how much did she make? So we've seen, if not this very same problem, we've seen problems like this before. One method that we use in the very, very beginning, we didn't use it long, probably half a class. We use bar models. It would look something like this. Here's her $9 for her 1 2-hour. And if we wanted to know what that would look like for 27 hours, we would have to continue that bar model for the 27 hours, right? And that can be really a tedious process, but we would have to continue that whole entire bar model to show that 27. I'm not going to even take the time to do that now, just because it's so tedious. Because we got to be a little bit more efficient by organizing this information into a table. So here's our 2 hours, $9. We can see that the next spot on the table is 1 hour. Let's figure out how many dollars that would be to then answer the question, okay, what about 27 hours? What is that going to be in dollars? So quickly discuss with your groups. How is the table maybe a little bit more helpful? What is, how are we using it? This should take you about maybe 20 seconds. Ready, set, go. Okay, let's finish up and now come back together. How did you use this table? And why is it better than drawing this bar model that I didn't even want to complete? Daxton, get us started, please. I agree. It's more organized. It's easier to get the specific information that we want. I would even say it's probably a little bit easier to generalize as well. That to figure out the 27 hours, we'd have to draw specifically 27. And then if I wanted to figure out the 54 hours, I'd have to draw 54 hours. And that can just be really tedious. So now help me out. How do I use this table? Across from the one, what is that going to be? 1 hour, how many dollars? Siley? Great. How did you get there? Okay, so you found a great pattern here in the table that I can turn a 2 into a 1 by dividing by 2. So I would do the same thing here, playing with our equivalent ratios. 9 divided by 2 is 450. Good. There's other ways that we can do this, right? How do we normally use our tables? We just reviewed it and we wrote it down, Carter. Good, because maybe we don't know how a 2 changes to a 9, right? We want to find that relationship of how does a 2 change to a 9, and maybe we don't know in the beginning. So in the beginning, we would probably work backwards and divide. And 9 divided by 2 is how I get to that 4.5. And now I know how I'm going across the table. I'm going across the table by multiplying by 4.5. And we can confirm that using Siley's method and figuring out the 1 hour is $4.50. We can see how does a 1 change to a 4.50? Clearly by multiplying by 450. And so then we can go forward in this table. 27 times $4.50. Thank you for those quick hands, Seth. Okay, $121.50. And again, the beauty of this is that we can generalize this even further to any number that I want. Like, what if we're gonna, what is it? Jennifer's babysitting, right? Yeah, what if Jennifer ends up babysitting for 54 hours over the course of a whole month? How much money is she going to be making? Well, we take that 54, we go forwards across the table in the same way, and we know that for 54 hours she's going to make Maverick. Sounds good. $243. Now, here's our third method. We've solved problems like this using a graph. Not too terribly often because the graph can be really hard to obtain that precision, but we can solve it using the graph. Looking at the graph that's already all done for us and already graphed, explain how we would use this graph that's already done for us to answer this question of how much money she would make for 27 hours. Quickly talk with your groups. Again, this should take about a 20-second discussion before we come back together. Ready, set, go. All right, let's come back together. How could we use this graph to help us answer the question about how much you would make after 27 hours? Thank you, Jaden. Where specifically would I look for where the x and the y meet? Do I look here? Would I look here? So let's review. Let's go back and review. Remember in the very, very, very beginning, we are told that she makes $9 for 2 hours of babysitting, and we want to know what if she babysits for 27 hours. Yep. So we would probably, first of all, we would need to look at the bottom because the bottom tells us the hours. What number would I be looking here on the bottom for? 27. I don't see it, but I know that 27 is going to be between 26 and 28, right? So then I would take that and know that that's the 27, and I could go up and say, hey, how about that? What number is. Ooh, that didn't work. What number going up is going to be associated with that? And this is where the graphs can be tricky, because can you tell that that's 2150? No, but it's a good thing that it's labeled here for us, right? That we know that that 27 hours would match the 12150. So especially if it's already nicely plotted for us, then we could see that the 27 hours corresponds with the $121.50. So we can use those pairs of coordinates to help us answer those questions. And I think of all of those methods so far, I think I prefer probably the table, because I think that the table gives us a great level of precision. It's pretty self-explanatory. We can easily find those patterns. But I want to also review the fact that we have written equations. We've done the hard work for writing the equation. Starting here, it doesn't have a spot for it, it's just right here. It says, write an equation for this situation and explain how we can use it to solve the problem. Then we're going to answer these questions, state the proportional constant or constant of proportionality, describe how you found it, and then answer a different question this time. How many hours did Jennifer work if she earned $150? This will take us a little bit more time. Let's take 60 seconds here. Online learners, pause the video until you've answered those questions. Ready, set, go. All right, we did all the hard work for writing the equation over here on the table. So what is that equation going to be? Who can share their equation with me? Thank you, Daxton. Yep, y equals x multiplied by 4.5. I'm going to pause here for a second. It says all the equations, we said this at the very beginning, that all of the equations would be in this format, y equals k times x. Is that equation correct? Yeah, it is correct. Because x times 4.5, is that really any different than 4.5 times x? No. So even if you wrote it a little bit different, understand that what we're doing is we're taking that x value, multiplying it by 4.5. So y equals 4.5x, and all other versions of that as well. Okay, now, oh, that should have been written up here. What is the proportional constant then? We should know we use the proportional constant in order to write this equation. We saw that proportional constant in our table in our previous example of this. So the proportional constant is 4.5, yes? And it's the number that we use to go across the table. But that's not how we found it in the beginning, is it? How did we find it in the very beginning? We worked backwards. We're going to tie that in here. How did we find it? We worked backwards. No idea why I suddenly changed to black there. We worked backwards. So we didn't know we had our 9. We worked backwards and divided it by 2. In other words, notice what that is. It's the y value divided by the x value. Just want to be able to make a connection to what's going on down here. So then, how many hours did Jennifer work if she were earned $150? Before we officially answer that question, let's back up for just a second. Remember the question that they're asking in the beginning is 27 hours. Let's answer that question first. What if we know that Jennifer worked 27 hours? How much money will she make? We already know the answer to this question because we've answered it multiple times. We're just using this new method. So using our equation, y equals 4.5x. What do I do with this information of 27 hours to help us find the dollar amount? How would I answer this question? Danielle. Yep. So instead of 4.5 times x, it's now 4.5 times 27 because our x represents the hours. So I know the x value. And we've done this calculation enough times that we know that y then is 121.5, or therefore she earned $121.50. Now let's answer the question that it's asking here. What if we don't know the hours, but this time we know she made $150? How do I use the equation to answer that question? Seth. Correct. So let's go back to the equation, make sure we understand how we're using it. Here, I knew the x value was 27 because I gave you the hours. And here, I'm not giving you the hours. Here, I'm giving you the dollars. So that means instead of plugging it into the x position and multiplying it, we're going to be plugging it in here to the y position. And then we have to divide in order to actually answer this and solve this equation. 150 is equal to 4.5 x. How do I solve this? How do I undo multiplying by x? We divide. So 150 divided by 4.5. It's kind of an interesting answer. We end up with x is equal to 33 and a third hours, right? It would be, yes, and that's exactly the connection that I wanted you to make. 33.3 over bar is what we get when we plug it into the calculator. What is that one third of an hour? One third of an hour is equal to 20 minutes. So probably the best, most appropriate way to answer, you can say 33 and a third of an hour, or you can say 33 hours and 20 minutes. So each one of those previous methods are ways that we have answered these types of questions in the past. You are still welcome to use every one of those methods, but I want to start introducing you to one that is going to be a little bit simpler and that has applications in higher mathematics courses, specifically in Math 2 when you're dealing with trigonometry. It's going to be really helpful. We have the equation y divided by x is equal to 4.5. It says it's a proportional relationship. Where did that come from? Came from right here, right? Where that k is the 4.5. Why did we do y divided by x? Because we were trying to find that proportional constant. We were trying to figure out how to go forwards, and so we worked backwards and we did y divided by x, which was equal to 4.5 for this particular problem. That is a proportional relationship. Now let's back up for a second. What is a proportional relationship? We have to go way back to the beginning of this unit. A proportional relationship or a proportion is an equation stating that two ratios are equivalent. We learned that from the very, very beginning, that a proportional relationship is a bunch of equivalent ratios. What we're going to be looking at now, though, let me highlight this real quick. A proportion is an equation stating that two ratios are equivalent. Here's a ratio. I can see that. This is the ratio y over x or y to x. This perhaps doesn't look exactly like a ratio because it's just a single number. So let's read this part in between now. Each side of the equation is a ratio. Y over x is the ratio of y to x, or money earned to hours worked. This 4.5 is really truly the ratio of 4.5 to 1, or $4.5 to 1 hour. So we're still taking all of the same concepts from before. We're going to write them a little bit different. We're now going to write these proportional relationships or these proportional equations like this, where we have a ratio equal to another ratio. Again, this is just a proportion. What it means is A is to B as C is to D, kind of like an analogy from English language arts. A over B is the same as C over D. We do need to be consistent with our units in the quantities that we are comparing. For example, we have dollars to hours. So that means the 9 refers to dollars and the 2 refers to hours. Which also means that when I'm trying to expand this problem and figure out, okay, what about 27 hours? That 27 is going to go on the bottom, same as these hours, and the dollars, our unknown amount, is going to go on the top. Let's pause for just a second. We're going to come down here and answer question D. What strategies can you use to solve this proportion? Again, understand how this proportion is created. We're just looking at equivalent ratios. So I'm looking at the ratio of dollars and hours. So I set up with the known information that was given to me. And that known information that was given to me is $9 in 2 hours. But then I'm going to also continue that with the information that is partial. I do know that ultimately I want to get this 2 to be a 27. I don't know, however, what the dollar amount is. So I'm using a variable there to express that. So understand how we created this proportion. And now I want you to figure out ways that you can solve it. Go back to what we've done in the past. You don't necessarily need to do a table or a graph like we've seen here. But what strategies can we use or have we used in the past to answer this question? Go ahead and quickly discuss with your groups. Take about 30 to 60 seconds to figure out how we can solve this proportion. Online learners, pause the video until you're ready to answer. All right, so what are some strategies that we've used in the past? Carter. Exactly. We're probably really familiar with asking this question, how does a 2 change to a 27? And we don't know that answer very easily. We could figure it out by working backwards, etc., but it does create a little bit of extra work for us. So instead, probably finding that unit rate, which we have already found in our previous method when we looked at the table, we can always go to the unit rate. How does a 2 change to a 1? Well, we would divide by 2. So what would I need to do up here? We would also need to divide by 2. And the 9 divided by 2 is 4.5. We're not surprised by that. We found that answer doing this problem previously. And now we're ready, because now I know, since I'm trying to turn this into a 27, how does the 1 change to a 27? We multiply by 27. So what am I going to be doing here? Multiplying by 27. And again, we've solved this many times, so we know that this number here that was D, that D is equal to 12150. Yes? Okay. Beautiful. And now that we know how to solve them, now that we've reviewed everything we need to know about proportions, we're going to look at solving these proportions a little bit differently, but that's going to happen in our future lesson. What I want to do first is, this the only possible proportion for this question? We wrote dollars over hours is equal to 9 over 2 is equal to D over 27. Is this the only possible proportion for this question? I'll give you the answer now. The answer is no. Is there anything that said it had to be dollars per hour? Could we flip this and write hours per dollar? Yeah. Is it a unit rate, or a rate that maybe makes the most sense? No. But is it another way that we could write this problem? Okay. So we could also have written the 2 hours per $9. And then we could have asked, okay, how many dollars there for our 27 hours? So I just want to make a connection, because this is what the main thing that we're going to be doing for the rest of class today is, writing two different proportions. We're not solving at all. Yes, you know how to solve, and that's great, but we're done solving for today. We're just going to start writing proportions. Here's what it looks like. Set up two proportions for each problem. Let me say that again, and we're going to highlight it. Set up two proportions for each problem. Be sure to write the units of your comparisons. You do not need to answer the question yet. That means you are not solving them. We're going to come back and solve for the missing quantities later. I'm just going to write the word later. The first one has been done for you, so let's look at the work that they have done. A 5-inch frog can leap 50 inches in one jump. If jumping distance is proportional to body length, how far should a 60-inch human be able to jump? Remember, we're not answering the question. We're just setting up two possible proportions. Here's what it looks like, and I'm just going to highlight here. We have body and jumping. So the body length of the frog was 5 inches, and that frog can jump 50 inches. The body length of this specific human is 60 inches. We want to know, how far can that human jump if it's proportional? That's it. You don't have to solve it. You're just going to write the proportion. We have done all of the things that it said to do. We have written the units in our comparison. So I have body and I have jumping. That's our units that we're looking at. And then I kept that unit consistent. Here's the body length of 5 inches, the body length of 60 inches, the jumping distance of 50 inches, and the jumping distance that I'm trying to find. So I'm using the variable J for jumping distance. It does, however, say that we need to set up two proportions. So how do I set up the second one? We simply turn it to its reciprocal. Reciprocal. So flip to the reciprocal, which means jumping distance that was on the bottom is now on the top, and body distance that was on the top is now on the bottom. What I'm asking you guys to do is actually so simple that I promise you, you guys are going to overcomplicate it and do it wrong. So really take the time. This right here, this is all that I want you to do. You should not be solving it. You're just writing two separate proportions. Let's practice it here with Eli. Eli won 2 out of 3 chess games one day. At this rate, if he played 33 games, how many did he win? So what I should be setting up is how many he won out of the total number that he played. There's my units. Now let's set that up. He won 2 out of 3. We're not done though, because it says at this rate, if he played 33 games, how many did he win? That means the played amount that needs to go on the bottom. And the won amount, which I don't know, needs to go on the top. What is a variable I could use for won? Probably W. We are not done. What else do we have to do? Another one, which all that means is we're flipping it to its reciprocal. So we're going to have played as the top part of that ratio per one as the bottom part of the ratio. He played 3, and of those 3, he won 2. If he plays 33, how many will he win? W. Do you need to solve it? Can you do that one mentally? Probably. But that's not the point. The point of this is just writing out those proportions. The rest of the time is yours. I do want you to finish 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. That is going to be homework. Okay? Your homework is simply writing out each of these proportions. You have a few minutes in class to get started. With any extra time that you do have, you can continue on to the homework section, where again, you're just going to be writing those proportions. You don't need to worry about solving them right now. That's it for today. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.